minus 20 seconds and counting. 15 seconds. 11, 10, 9.
It's an incredible experience because you actually feel the vibration as the shuttle lifts towards the sky.
One, we have booster ignition and liftoff of Space Shuttle Columbia with a multitude of national and international space research experiments.
I remember it was uneventful, you know? It was just another launch.
Columbia, you sent your go at throttle up.
We copy, go at throttle up.
I was mindful every time, on every mission, that they knew that they might not make it back.
Flight controllers have been carefully studying some damage that occurred. It appears some insulation broke loose from the big orange fuel tank and damaged the protective tiles on Columbia's left wing on the way up.
All of the analysis suggests that it would be very minor.
The last communications with the shuttle Columbia during its descent from orbit were at about 8 a.m. Central Time.
Oh my goodness. That's unprecedented. That's not good. Yeah, they're supposed to be landing right now. They're not here. Where are they?
I can still see that the video of the sky and the streaks across the sky. And I kept thinking, is there any way that there could be a mistake? And yet all of the evidence was just so obvious.
During its final approach in the skies over Central Texas, a catastrophic failure dooming the mission.
17 years after the Shuttle Challenger disaster, today Columbia broke apart just moments before landing at the Kennedy Space Center.
Amazing grace.
These people very much felt like family members had been lost.
That's the workforce. That's the space program right there. Those are the people who put them up safely and hope to bring them back safely.
Seven heroes lost their lives. And it's good to talk about who they were and the difference they made and the difference their sacrifice made.
My name's Dan Billow. I was a reporter for 33 years for WESH 2 and covered the space program.
Dan Billow and Claire Metz back with you at the Kennedy Space Center. T-minus 6 minutes, 40 seconds. Claire will come up in just a moment here. The countdown has resumed. No problems with Columbia?
The mission was a space lab mission, so there was something like 80 experiments being flown, experiments that could be done only in space. It was also kind of a public relations mission, too. The first Israeli astronaut, Ilan Ramon.
Happy to be here, finally.
Ilan Ramon has fought in two wars for Israel. Now his mission is about politics and science.
And any time you get an Israeli, in that era, in that day and age, a prominent Israeli is going to be perhaps the focus of terrorism.
Fighter planes, missiles, and commandos are on hand at the Kennedy Space Center to protect Ramon and his crewmates. The astronauts and NASA leaders are confident Columbia will launch safely.
That's what we were all focused on. And focused too on somewhat the fact that this would be one of the last non-space station missions.
The astronauts will spend 16 days, one of the longest shuttle missions, performing 59 experiments. They'll look for ways to improve Earth's environment, public health, and astronauts' ability to live and work in space.
They were doing this in a science lab, so really unable to go to the space station, which was kind of in its infancy, but it was up there.
My name is Greg Fox, and I've been at WESH TV since May of 1987.
They had a terrific experience, and perhaps none better than Tarek Adwan. He is a Palestinian student.
One of the things I remember about the last flight of Columbia is that I had the job of speaking with a couple of students who were visiting. They had an experiment on board. One of them was Palestinian, one of them was Israeli. And this was really a strong moment, really, if you will, in national relations as well as science.
But we decided that it's very important that we work together because it's more productive trying to make this world a better place to live in.
I talked to both of them. They were extremely excited. They wanted to see the experiment succeed. More than anything, they were thrilled to see the first Israeli astronaut going up aboard the shuttle Columbia.
My name is Nancy Alvarez. I'm an anchor and reporter here at WESH 2 News, and I have been in the news business for 23 years. My first job in news, I was 23 years old and I was assigned Brevard County. And under the Brevard Bureau job was the Kennedy Space Center, a new reporter and assigned the space program. I covered, you know, the launch of Columbia, and I don't remember talking about safety. I was talking about the astronauts and the excitement of Ilan Ramon for Israel and Kalpana Chawla for India and the stories of these people and their families. That was the focus.
The astronauts obviously on board and the weather in good shape, and there is Columbia ready to go. Let's give you a quick look at the seven people putting their lives on the line for science. On this flight, they walked out of the operation.
And we have our seven astronauts seated at breakfast.
Yeah, they were quite a mixture. Rick Husband was the commander. Rick Husband was somebody who everybody loved. He was that likable guy who was in control and in command and did it in a way that he made you think that you were the best at it. And so likable.
William, or Willie McCool, is our pilot on his first flight.
A young guy, a go-getter, a military pilot like all space shuttle astronauts.
On this mission, he'll be responsible for maneuvering Columbia as part of several experiments mounted in the shuttle's payload bay.
Laurel Clark, she's so interesting.
Mission specialist on her first flight. She too became an astronaut back in 1996.
Her family had been in something, you know, kind of a minor aircraft accident just a couple months before. Her son was there in the plane. He had a premonition, this child, that this space mission, this space flight, was going to end in disaster. He begged his mother not to go. He begged her not to go.
David Brown, mission specialist, his first flight. He was initially assigned to support the payload development for the International Space Station. Mike Anderson, he's the payload commander as well as mission specialist on this mission. This is his second flight. He first became an astronaut back in 1994. His first flight was STS-89 to the Mir space station. And Ilan Ramon, colonel in the Israeli Air Force.
I attach myself so closely to Ilan Ramon. He was the first Israeli astronaut. We saw him out there with his family and these little kids, you know, following him around. He was handsome. He looked like a superhero.
Okay.
Being married to the world's most watched astronaut at the moment is a whirlwind for Rona Ramon. She's whisked from place to place in Cocoa Beach in a heavily armed motorcade, while her husband, Ilan Ramon, prepares for his launch tomorrow. We're finally getting to the moment, she says in Hebrew. It's really happening. It's like a dream.
Mission specialist, Kalpana Chawla.
First Indian female astronaut, and she was just such a source of pride. I remember for her father, who I saw out there.
She had been kind of a lightning rod for criticism because the high profile mission that she had done was to try to capture a satellite with the robot arm. There's a satellite floating out there in space. She was the one to try to grab onto it with the robot arm. It didn't work. This was kind of redemption for her to be assigned to another mission.
This is a crew coming out of their crew quarters as a unit.
These people just meant so much to so many. And I think that's what made the mission special.
And they are getting onto the elevator that will take them down to the ground floor. And our astronauts coming out now as they are making their way to the astronaut van.
It'll be about 5:45 or so in Israel when this launch goes, if all goes well.
What I really remember of launch day was the security.
The dawning day would bring triumph or disaster. The unprecedented security team here to protect the astronauts and their families was determined to make it the former.
My job on the morning of the launch on January 16th was to really get an idea of the crowd bigness, if you will.
Now let's see if we can get Greg Fox across the river as we get down close to the 2-minute mark here, just briefly.
Dan, a big crowd, and some of these people have been watching since early this morning, the F-16.
And they were lined all along the Space Coast. I remember it being really cold. You know, I had a turtleneck on and then a heavy shirt, and before that, coats for earlier morning live shots. People were just lined up, waiting for it to go up, hoping it would go up. Everybody knows when you go to a shuttle launch, you know, is it gonna go? Are we really gonna see it?
Start, Columbia's onboard computers have primary control of all the vehicle's critical functions.
And of course, as soon as the countdown went to zero.
Three, two, We have booster ignition and liftoff of Space Shuttle Columbia.
And the shuttle went up. People were cheering, and of course, then they felt that immense wave of pressure coming across the Indian River, and it just punches you in the gut as you're seeing the shuttle go up.
Roger, roll, Columbia.
What a blue sky and great day for launch. It's the first time in about 10 months. This is the 113th flight of the space shuttle, and it has an excellent safety record.
I remember I was assigned to getting reaction, and I remember somebody said at some point, Ilan Ramon's family is heading back to the hotel. See if you can catch them. And I approached them, and I remember, I think I asked his wife how she was feeling, and she expressed, you know, excitement, and that it was a beautiful launch, and it was incredible. And then what I will remember for the rest of my life, his daughter, who was 5 years old at the time, had a little baggie, and she had a mission pin in this bag. And she took out the pin, and she handed it to me. And I had it in my hand, and I remember what the pin looked like, and I said, oh my gosh, thank you so much. This is so nice of you. And her brother was standing next to her, and he said, you know that's your last pin. And I looked at him, and I looked at her, and she just kind of shrugged. And I said, don't give me your last pin. You need to keep this pin. And she goes, okay. So I gave her back the pin. And I'm so glad I did. You know, I look back on that, and it was such a minor, silly thing. And that exchange with her was so ordinary, but then it became extraordinary after everything happened.
The day before landing, there was a routine pre-landing news conference held by the flight director.
Speaking of launch, flight controllers have been carefully studying some damage that occurred. It appears some insulation broke loose from the big orange fuel tank and damaged the protective tiles on Columbia's left wing on the way up.
And he was asked a question or two about it and talked a little bit about a piece of foam insulation that came from the external tank of the shuttle and hit the orbiter itself, hit the left wing.
We can't say with great detail the degree of the damage, other than all of the analysis suggests that it would be very minor.
And we're in a fireball.
The shuttle gets red hot when it returns to Earth. The tiles keep it from burning up. But mission managers are certain the minor damage is no threat to the astronauts' survival.
They couldn't tell from the views that they had of exactly where it hit the wing. They thought it struck the underside, but they weren't sure. And he said, you know, we're not sure about a whole lot of this. We really don't know a lot about it. And that right there was an alarm bell that went off, not knowing about it. That's trouble right there sometimes. And so I think that's what kind of got me interested right away.
Dan Billow from WESH-TV. Leroy, could you just review what the minor damage is to the tile on the left wing?
I believe that at this time, we can't say with great detail the degree of the damage, other than all of the analysis suggests that it would be very minor in terms of the amount of tile that might actually be missing or had been removed.
He dismissed it completely, said it's no safety of flight issue, the astronauts are at no risk, but I reported it anyway because there were unknowns about it. And unknowns, I learned from NASA. Okay, NASA taught me that unknowns are bad. So that struck me the day before. So I made sure I put it out there, put it on the record. How I prepared for a landing was, one thing I would do was my homework and kind of brush up on exactly what the different milestones were as they left orbit and came home.
Columbia Houston for Rick, we'll take another item 27.
All the while doing the other kind of half of my job that every TV reporter deals with, is making sure that everything worked on this end. You know, so I spent half the morning going, can you hear me now? Can you hear me now?
We all loaded up on the media, you know, bus that takes us out to the landing strip, and I could see the families in the distance on the bleachers. And the bleachers were packed with people, and I can't stress enough just how ordinary it all was.
I always insisted that I must hear what was coming from NASA in one ear independently, nothing else in that ear, hear channel 2, for example, Raul Martinez, the anchor that morning, hear him and my producer and the program, what channel 2 was broadcasting, in the other ear. Had to be independent, and I have to have undivided as much as possible attention on what is going on and not miss anything.
And News Channel 2 space reporter Dan Billow is live at the Kennedy Space Center now and joins us.
But the problem was, here I am broadcasting and talking about what the plans are to land and so forth, and I'm not hearing this ear.
Really not hearing much from Mission Control. I'm almost starting to doubt whether the sound is working very well.
I kind of assumed that something else is broken. Well, we had a lot of stuff that didn't quite work as well as we wanted it to that day. Well, finally, they spoke up again.
Now, here we go.
We will continue to seek tracking or communications with the Columbia through Merritt Island Tracking Station.
Immediately, the moment they started talking about this, I knew that this hadn't happened before.
Well, communications with Columbia was at 8 a.m. Central Time, approximately above Texas, as it approached the Kennedy Space Center for its landing.
Wow.
Flight Director Leroy Kane is now instructing controllers to get out their contingency procedures and begin to follow those.
Oh, my goodness. That's unprecedented. That's not good.
And I stood in front of the camera, and the time came and went. And we, all of us, just started doing this. All of us, I remember everybody. Experienced or not, you know, journalists, Kennedy Space Center employees. And then there was just so much confusion. I looked at the bleachers and it was like a sudden wave. Like they all got up almost at the same time. And it was this immediate wave of clearing out those bleachers and those family members and getting them, you know, away from that runway.
Please back up and go back to the press site. We are trying to close operations here. We'll go back to the press site.
I just was convinced that, like, I was missing something. Like, the shuttle landed somewhere, and I just hadn't found out about it yet because I don't have the connections that Dan Billow has. So Dan Billow, I'm sure, knows exactly what happened, but I don't because I'm new here, you know? And it wasn't long after I got to the press site where I realized, no, we were all confused. We were all in a state of shock.
The last communications, as you heard, from the space shuttle, we were just after 9 o'clock. He said 8 o'clock Central Time, just after 9 o'clock our time. That's 15 minutes ago. Right now we're counting down to 3 seconds to landing. Yeah, they're supposed to be landing right now. They're not here. Where are they? They're lost.
They were supposed to be up there above us by the time that they were starting to say, well, we've lost contact, and that I was able to hear that.
Columbia, Houston, UHF comm check.
Not being in contact with the space shuttle at a time when they must be very close to Florida is a big, big problem instantaneously. I mean, that is absolutely the wrong thing.
This is... this is a bad thing. There's not much you can say about it. We are a minute and a half past the scheduled landing time. The space shuttle is not here. This has never happened before. They are gone.
I thought that they must be gone forever. Like anyone, I wanted a miracle to happen.
And give you a look at a video that is from Dallas, and that is hauntingly reminiscent of the Challenger disaster. That
when
is
you're a reporter, you report what the official information is. So you wait for NASA to declare them gone forever.
This day has brought terrible news.
Now, that didn't happen until the president spoke at 2 o'clock that afternoon. However, I thought that there was very, very, very little chance. You cannot parachute out of a space shuttle that's going 14,000 miles an hour. You know, you just, there aren't any scenarios for this that end well. We didn't have the information yet that Mission Control had that morning, that things like the tire pressure in the landing gear had gone to zero.
FYI, I've just lost four separate temperature transducers on the left side of the vehicle.
The last moments that we're aware of, we became aware of better in terms of the public, when that recording was released by NASA some weeks later of what all went on in the Mission Control Center. So you've got sensors that have, that show the temperature, that show the strain, that show various kinds of measurements going on all over the space shuttle, including, of course, the left wing.
Where is that instrumentation located?
And first you lose a couple of temperature sensors. In other words, they go black. They're not working anymore. Well, no, there are more than 1,000 of these kind of sensors, and sometimes things don't work perfectly. It's probably not a big deal. And then something else in the couple of other sensors in the left wing go.
One of them is located in the aft part of the left wing.
Wow, what is this about the left wing? And then the tire pressure finally, and they're starting to discuss this with the flight director. Then the tire pressures go to zero.
The tires feel the pressure on left outboard and left inboard both tires.
Well, these are the tires in the wheel well on the left wing. Everything is left wing. And when you lose pressure on the tires, you know, that automatically, that is a huge deal. You can't land without your tires. That was the moment when, you know, the pucker factor in Mission Control got turned up all the way, that it was real, real serious. And it wasn't just instrumentation. They had a huge problem on their hands.
In Columbia, Houston, we see your tire pressure messages, and we did not copy your lab.
Instrumentation, man.
And then the communication started to drop out. And there was the moment where Charlie Hobaugh, the Capcom, says, "We see your tire pressure messages and we cannot copy your last." Husband tries to respond and gets as far as, and then he's cut off.
Roger.
And that was right at 8:59 and 32 seconds, the instant that all communication, everything was lost. If you know what's going on and know about the sensors going and know about the tire pressures going, and then communications get scratchy and disappear, then you know how grave it is and how frightening it is, how disastrous it might be. But we in the public weren't in on that. What I find hard to forget is Leroy Kane saying,
"GC flight. Flight GC, lock the doors. Copy."
Lock the doors. And his voice was husky and his voice was like his throat was constricted. You know, he knew. He knew too. Just like I knew, he knew too.
Final, weren't you expecting tracking?
1 minute ago, flight.
What could happen at that altitude? Why anything could happen at that altitude is just absolutely unknown. You know, we know of a what was considered to be a minor problem.
When did I connect the dots of the foam strike with the loss of the space shuttle? Within something like 5 or 10 minutes of landing time, while I was still at the runway, I was talking about that.
But during launch, a piece of insulation on the shuttle's big external fuel tank apparently came loose and struck the left wing of Columbia. Now, this was 16 days ago at launch. Mission managers figured that the damage to the wing was very small. I'm going to have our cameraman, Rick, go down and get that tape from yesterday. We'll lock down the camera, we'll get that press conference from yesterday, and we'll use both responses.
All I knew was what I had heard the day before, was that there had been something that hit the wing and there was a lot that was not known about it. And now they're gonna have to find out if that indeed is the thing that killed the astronauts, and it turned out to be.
I remember that morning very vividly. My name is Jim Payne. I'm an anchor at WESH 2 and I've been at the station for 22 years. I was sitting at the kitchen table, leafing through the paper and having some coffee and bantering with my boys, and I had WESH on, and I was listening to Dan Billow talk about what was coming up, sort of hearing him but not really paying close attention. And at one point his tone changed, and I don't remember exactly what he said, but I remembered thinking, this is not good. And then Dan started talking about there's a countdown clock to landing.
We are a minute and a half past the scheduled landing time. The space shuttle is not here. This has never happened before.
And I didn't have to listen long to figure out what was going on, and knew that I was going to be needed at the station as quickly as humanly possible.
I was in the Ocala National Forest, on the edge of it at the Boy Scout camp in Central Florida, with a Cub Scout pack. Other Scout leaders had been milling around camp. They had said, have you heard, have you heard? At that point, I hadn't heard the news of what had happened. And that's when I ran back to my tent and I checked my pager, and it was blunt, you know, come to work, Shuttle Columbia.
I was probably not more than 2-3 miles down the road when the first report of the streaks in the sky over Texas started coming in. And there was a lot of speculation over what that was, but it was obvious to those of us who follow space and the shuttle program that was the shuttle breaking up. It was just in the right place at the right time, and getting that same sick feeling again that I had as I was driving in.
I'm thinking in my mind, you know, could this possibly have happened again? You know, we had just had Challenger in 86, and you thought that they had worked out everything that could possibly happen. We knew about the foam coming loose, striking the side of the shuttle. We thought that they were working on that. I mean, the presumption was that they were working on the heat shield and everything was okay.
To do what we do, you have to prepare yourself the right way. You have to be in the right sort of mindset, and you have to convey the right emotion for the moment to be an effective communicator. And I just felt terrible. And I kept thinking, gosh, I really don't want to have to do this, but I'm going to go in there and do this and try and be the best at it in this moment that I can be.
The last transmission that NASA is reporting, Columbia, Houston, we see your tire pressure messages and we did not copy your last.
Dan had already been forced out of his broadcast position, so it was on Wendy and me to kind of carry the day at that point.
But we are told that this is a video from the Nacogdoches area in East Texas. You see the police tape there and a piece of shuttle debris.
What I saw, I immediately noticed were a lot of spherical objects, kind of like basketballs made of metal. And knowing and hearing very careful commentary that we were getting from the network and from the stations in Texas and so forth, where they would be getting these shots of this stuff. And also, there were a couple of shots of obviously panels of space shuttle heat tiles, the square tiles, and several other things. And I knew immediately what they were. You know, in hearing everybody being so careful not to say what it was easy to say what it was. We were among the first to be able to kind of identify what nobody else was willing to identify or try to identify.
That is an identifiable piece of the space shuttle, and what it was that's a tile. And you can see that it's one of the black tiles from the underside, probably, of the space shuttle. And when we got a closer look, you could see that part of the black, there it is, has come off, exposing the white part of the tile underneath. And that really is pretty unmistakably a piece of the Space Shuttle Columbia.
I have very vivid memories of Dan describing in great detail, using models, what had happened and why it happened the way that it was.
Broke off and appeared like it went down and struck what would have been right here, the left wing.
I can't remember exactly where it was in the coverage. But he was talking about the tiles, the protective tiles on the outside of the shuttle.
Yeah, this is one of the white tiles. The tile that is black is coated with the black so that it can withstand greater heat. And
I remember Dan holding up one of those tiles and taking a pencil and just sticking it into the tile. And I thought, ooh, I didn't know that.
Fragility of the tiles of the space shuttle, you know, it's that easy to make a hole in it. It is that easy.
I was able to do that because, you know, I've been here for years and years and years, and every now and then NASA will let us into the processing areas, the places where the space shuttles are kept in between flights. And over the years, you know, over 20 years or whatever it was to do that so many times, you kind of get to know almost every part of the spaceship.
Everybody had assignments, who was going to go to Texas, who's going to go out to Brevard County, to try to get a sense of what was going on.
News Channel 2's Greg Fox is live in Titusville now with more on that. Greg?
My assignment that day was to go out and talk to just regular folks. What are they hearing? What are they talking about? How are they reacting to the worst possible news?
Jeff Marr is a shuttle engineer. Bill Wooten, a launch mechanic.
I know that the number one thing out there is safety, and I just couldn't understand how something like this could have happened. I mean, I was just like, I was devastated.
You feel lost, but when people are lost, such as a shuttle, it's you feel a deep loss.
What I did on TV that day just was simply try to convey that feeling of shock and helplessness at the Kennedy Space Center. People in Texas weren't supposed to be busy that day. You know, this wasn't their story, it was our story. And when we were left with nothing, no landing, no shuttle, nothing to talk about except the shock of it all.
I'm Dave McDaniel, I'm a WESH TV news reporter. I've been here since March of 1988. On the morning that this all occurred, my wife and I, we'd loaded up our horse and our carriage, and we were gonna go out to the Big Little Gun State Forest. We were gonna have a nice day bombing around the woods in the horse and carriage. And I get a call from here, from the newsroom. All I hear is, McD, there's a plane ticket waiting for you at the airport. You're meeting Frank Bird out there. You've got a 12:30 flight to Texas.
Search and rescue teams in the Dallas-Fort Worth area have been alerted.
I said, for what? He goes, well, haven't you heard? I go, heard what? He goes, the shuttle has blown up over Texas. It disintegrated on reentry. And I had no idea that that had occurred. It was a scramble to make the flight, but we made it, and you know, we landed in Texas a few hours later.
My name is Amanda Dukes, formerly Amanda Ober. I have been a reporter at WESH for 25 years. I had the TV on. I don't remember how much attention I was paying to the coverage, but at one point, I do remember seeing Dan Billow explaining that something was wrong, but he didn't know what was wrong. And not long after that, I did get a phone call from my news managers here at Channel 2 asking how quickly I could pack a bag and if I was willing to leave in a few hours to fly to Houston to the Johnson Space Center.
We have sent two crews to Texas. News Channel 2's Dave McDaniel is near Tyler, Texas, where there are reports of debris from the shuttle. Right now, though, we want to check in with News Channel 2's Amanda Ober. She's live at the Johnson Space Center in Houston. And Amanda, what's been...
My job on the ground in Houston was to report how the community that knew and loved these astronauts was processing this.
It is a very personal loss that's being felt here at the Johnson Space Center. This is home of the shuttle program. It's where the astronauts train, and Houston is where their families live.
Already there were flowers and balloons and cards, just a growing pile at the entrance to the Space Center, and these were being left by people who worked at the Space Center, people who didn't know the astronauts but just lived in that community. And many of them were very emotional. As they walked up to lay down their flowers, to leave their card, they were crying. And I was hit with the gravity of the loss for this community, that it was very personal.
Voices were raised and so were hands at the Houston area church astronauts Rick Husband and Michael Anderson called home.
I attended at least three memorial services for the astronauts. And I'll never forget, one of the memorial services for the astronauts was at a church, just a local church in Houston. But one third of the members of that church had worked specifically with the Columbia crew.
This hurts. We've lost seven friends.
And so you can only imagine the palpable grief that this church was feeling. Many of the people who were at the memorial service had been in Bible studies with them. Their kids had played sports with their kids. And so I think we can tend to think of astronauts as these larger-than-life heroes, almost celebrities, which they are. But they're also just people who live really remarkably ordinary lives when they're not doing their space thing.
Here at the Johnson Space Center, people continue to turn their sense of loss into something tangible by leaving items at this makeshift memorial. Now, NASA employees, many who returned to work today for the first time since the tragedy, say this message of support is getting through loud and clear. Imagine if your job every day is to help make sure that these astronauts have a successful mission and are safe, that they come back home safely, and then they don't. You know, there's a lot of grief there. And I think those memorial services were critical in helping people just heal and move forward.
We're in Nacogdoches, Texas, which is basically the center of the debris field, which seems to be.
I think by the time that we landed, it was fairly clear that all the evidence of what Columbia was going to be in East Texas. Very rural, Hemp Hill, Nacogdoches, that area, all the way to like the Louisiana border.
News Channel 2's Dave McDaniel is live in Rusk, Texas right now, a small town that is inside the debris field. Dave.
Wendy, we're in the command center at the Cherokee County Sheriff's Office. All day calls have been coming in here, people reporting space shuttle debris. Look at this map in just Cherokee County. Every single pushpin is a report of debris of some size or shape.
These are little communities. These are small towns. They could not have been more gracious, and they were very accommodating because they lived through it too. In many ways, I think everybody was a victim, right? I mean, anybody who cared about the space program or cared about the shuttle astronauts, the science that goes into all of it, you're all kind of victimized by it because you are saluting them as they go up and you expect them to come home.
Entire families drawn to a makeshift memorial.
There's one in particular that stands out, and I believe the town was Hemp Hill, Texas. The guy I was working with, Frank, he had a video and he told me there's this little boy and a little girl and they're walking up and they had roses in their hand. And he had video of them placing them at this memorial that was at this community park. And he said, if we interview any children, he said, I've got really good video of these kids, you know, very poignant, you know, they were somber. So I asked the gentleman standing behind these two kids, are they your children? He goes, yeah. I go, do you care if we interview them? And he goes, no, go ahead. And I talked to the young guy, I think he was 7. And I said, was it important to be here today? And he said some of the things you'd expect, that, you know, he was trying to offer some comfort. And then he said, it's really been bothering me ever since I found one of the astronauts. And I looked up at his dad and I go, did he really say he found one of the astronauts? And he goes, yeah, he was out with his four-wheeler and he came across one of the Columbia astronauts.
I felt like it would help him, and he feels like it would help him just to pay tribute to those families.
The little boy was, you know, as cute as could be, you know, red hair, freckles, and I will always remember that face.
NASA needs all of the parts as they continue their investigation. They're going to try to reassemble the orbiter to figure out exactly what happened.
Everybody's looking for anything and everything related to the shuttle, because obviously everybody wanted to have an explanation for what in the world happened. And at one point, we were on the scene of where the nose cone was found in East Texas.
The nose cone's covered in plastic to protect it until it can be removed. Found late Monday, moving it may prove difficult because it hit the ground with significant force.
NASA now says it has one leading theory about what caused the Space Shuttle Columbia tragedy.
It centers right here. Watch what's highlighted. You see foam insulation coming off the shuttle's fuel tank.
NASA knew the foam broke away the day after launch. This was a 16-day flight, so there was a long time to study and know about if anything could be done, do something about this foam strike. So there's a team at the Kennedy Space Center whose job is to study the high resolution, high speed film and video taken with all these cameras that are pointed at the shuttle as it's going up. And this team spotted right away that there was something big that came off of the space shuttle, off the external tank, and hit the wing. So NASA knew within 24 hours. And people here at the Kennedy Space Center were getting very concerned about that.
I've just lost 4 separate temperature transducers on the left side of the vehicle, hydraulic return temperatures.
That's Flight Controller Jeffrey Kling verbalizing precisely what he and others had discussed one day before Columbia broke up over Texas. Kling wrote in an email, "If we actually saw our instrumentation in the wheel wells disappear during entry, then I suspect the landing gear will not deploy." He recommended to set up for a bailout. Another engineer wrote to Kling and others, "Why are we talking about this on the day before landing and not the day after launch? If you lost all the hydraulics, bailout is your only option." Another engineer suggested that Columbia astronauts make a spacewalk to check the wing. That wasn't done either. Still other emails suggest that NASA's top management should have been better informed of these concerns and options. While the flight control team was discussing drastic measures, here's what the flight director was saying publicly about the wing damage.
All of the analysis suggests that it would be very minor.
It seemed like mission managers didn't want to know much more about it. They were kind of dismissing it, in part saying, well, there's nothing we can do about it anyway, so never mind. How can NASA say that? Back in the day, it was, I don't care if it's impossible, do it anyway. Failure is not an option. You know, Leroy Kane, I don't want to blame it all on him, but sat in the very same seat as Gene Kranz, the guy who said in Apollo 13, failure is not an option. I don't care that it's impossible, do it anyway. I don't know why they were so convinced that there was nothing they could do.
Spy satellites had good opportunities to photograph the shuttle.
The folks on the ground here at Kennedy couldn't make the managers listen to get military classified systems to take pictures that might have helped. They might have shown the damage. Then again, they might not have. This is not perfect. It's not easy to do. But you might as well do it and try. And the military was willing to do it. In fact, called NASA several times saying, hey, we're ready to go. We'll do this for you. You want us to do it? No, you don't? Okay. Called them back. Are you sure you don't want us to do this? Because we can. We're happy to do it. That was one of the things that just, you know, when you have a safety mindedness, you should do. And it just didn't happen.
We want to know if we made any mistakes.
Clear images show a briefcase-sized piece of styrofoam-like insulation weighing less than 3 pounds hitting Columbia's left wing as the shuttle travels around 2,000 miles an hour. Pre-landing analysis said the impact could have opened a 7-by-30-inch gash in the tiles that protect the surface and could have caused structural damage, but then concluded,
even though you might have localized structural damage, you would not have damage sufficient to cause a catastrophic event nor impact the flying qualities of the vehicle.
Some of NASA's own experts in mission control disagreed with that conclusion, but Shuttle Chief Ron Dittamore says he was not made aware of that at the time.
It's glowing, look at that.
On Saturday, Columbia had to cope with 3,000 degree temperatures, same as shown in this previous landing, and that left wing began to fail. The shuttle's flight computer fired maneuvering rockets to try to keep it under control. Could the lives of the crew have been saved? Maybe, if any damage to the hidden underside of Columbia had been apparent before they tried to come home.
You would have had to make the decision that you were going to sacrifice the vehicle and get to a certain altitude and ask the crew to bail out.
What the chairman of the Accident Investigation Board did was to have kind of the same reaction that a lot of people had of, what do you mean failure is an option? You know, go back and be the NASA of old times and do a and try to figure it out. Now, all hands on deck, hell for leather effort to try to rescue this shuttle crew. Could you have done it if you tried? Can you kind of sit by and just let that happen, or do you bring them home? That would have been the decision they would have had to make in this scenario if they mounted this rescue effort. But what came back was, there is something you can do. You can try, and you can actually have a plausible chance, a reasonable chance of succeeding. Maybe it won't succeed. Maybe they'll die. So there was, in fact, something you could do. It may not have worked, but there was something that was at least plausible and reasonable that they could have tried.
Accident investigators, in advance of their final report, have recommended better inspections, better photography, and new techniques to repair shuttles in flight.
We find the safety organization is, on paper, perfect.
But when you bore down a little bit deeper, you don't find any there. There's no people, money, engineering, expertise.
Investigators say NASA's ineffective management was just as much to blame for the accident as the debris that struck the wing. Changing the culture that buried concerns about the debris hit is just as important as improving the hardware.
Here at Kennedy as well, our rivers of tears flow.
Seven heroes lost their lives. And it's good to talk about who they were and the difference they made and the difference their sacrifice made.
We're gathered here this morning to honor and salute the Columbia crew of mission STS-107.
Something that struck me that, you know, has been one of my strongest memories, which was the memorial service for Columbia on the runway here.
This crew lived lives that deserve our celebration. Yes, they were cut short, but these brave men and women lived their lives to the fullest.
We in Central Florida are the people who touch the space shuttle and fix the space shuttle and take care of the space shuttle and turn the wrenches and get it ready for launch and launch it. The space shuttles are here for us. So it was also a memorial for not just the people, the astronauts, but for an object, a spaceship.
America's first space shuttle, and the shuttle has cleared the tower.
And Bob Crippen, who was the first person to fly Columbia.
I was here at the shuttle runway in March of 1978.
Spoke very eloquently about the space shuttle, about Columbia, as kind of a friend.
Columbia was hardly a thing of beauty, except to those of us who loved and cared for her. Just as her crew has, Columbia has left us quite a legacy.
It was the first space shuttle. And that space shuttle was falling apart for thousands of miles and tried to hang in there. Tried to hang in there, but couldn't make it home.
Columbia had a great many missions ahead of her. She, along with the crew, had her life snuffed out in her prime.
Can you love a spaceship? And the answer is yes. You know, that we here, the spaceships are special to us in Central Florida. You can love a spaceship. And we loved Columbia. And she died a hero.